First of all, my thanks for the invitation to be here. I'm very pleased to be here. I offer my thanks to Father Thomas, a former student of mine, but also to the rector, Father Dennis Robinson, and then also for the presence of Dr. Patrick Cooper, three former Louvain people. I recall actually with Father Dennis, he edited Louvain Studies quite a number of years ago. Can't quite see him in the audience at the moment, but I do remember writing a piece called Consecrated Thought between the priest and the philosopher, which was published in that. And Father Thomas wrote on Edith Stein under my supervision, and I was, in fact, on the reading committee for Dr. Patrick Cooper, which dealt especially with the thinking of Jean-Luc Marion, the French thinker. So my thanks for the welcome and for the hospitality, for the Benedictine hospitality that I've had in the very brief period that I've been here. Well, I brought Irish weather, perhaps. I was out in California in January, and the good Lord save us, I brought Irish weather to California. And I was going there looking for California weather, but they offered their thanks to me because they had been suffering from an extreme drought for 5 years. So the rain gods from the Emerald Island helped them out. They probably need to be helped out in many other ways too, but at least that's a beginning. So I have a paper here, but I'll mix reading passages from it with some perhaps more extemporized explanation of the themes at issue. We have an hour or so. Easter week is coming up, and I think that that's the time of penitential meditation. I hope what I have to say tonight isn't too much of a prelude to that penitential meditation. So just again, a quick overview of the themes. So Aquinas' third way to God is sometimes called the argument from contingency, though Aquinas himself speaks of possible and necessary being. It possesses a surface lucidity that hides recessed depths. Contingent being is possible being because it might possibly not be. The third way might be said to say, this is as I take it, if all being is only possible being, then no being is possible. If something is, we need not an impossible being, but a necessary being, which is named as God. So I want to reflect on the fact that many intellectuals today have lost the taste for these thoughts. Why is this? Here I will reflect on what I call a default atheism that is quite common among contemporary intellectuals. Then I will offer some thoughts as to how the matter might be considered otherwise. And again, I will draw from my book, Being God in the Between, where I talk about what I call the hyperboles of being. And one of these I call the idiocy of being. Now again, when people hear me using the word idiocy, they sometimes break out in goosebumps, but especially if they're rationalistic in their philosophical inclinations. So let me, you know, ask them to be patient, and hopefully the goosebumps won't be too big tonight. So I'll explain this. In terms of the fact that things happen to be, there is a that it is about their being at all that is not necessary. Ontological astonishment before the that it is at all of contingent being opens up the thought of its coming to be, a coming to be that exceeds imminent becoming and raises our perplexity about the original source of all coming to be. So I will suggest that the idiocy of being is not the absurdity of being. Rather, there is an ontological intimacy to its givenness that precipitates mindfulness concerning what seems to exceed finite determination and the so-called imminent frame, a phrase of Charles Taylor. So I will come to the third way a little bit towards the end and also make some remarks on other thinkers like Kant and Hegel and Nietzsche. Okay, that's a mouthful or two even to begin. First of all, this idea of default atheism. Again, I'm in a situation in a community where I suppose the orientation would be a default theism. I'll make reference to that too in a second, but certainly among Western intellectuals in particular, and it's not just merely the philosophers, but when scientists are asked about their belief, there seems to have been a shift in the 20th century from a majority who claim to be believers to a majority who seem to claim the opposite. So there's a kind of a, I don't know if it's just group thinking to a certain extent, but that reflects something of the ethos of intellectual life that is worth noting in Western societies in any case. Now, one dimension of a default position is that it's usually a taken for granted position, but it makes possible certain forms of thought without itself being the object of thought. Now, I think that atheism has become a default position in that regard. Another dimension of a default position concerns the fact that it is a position on which a systematic construction depends and to which the construction reverts when it's put under pressure that threatens it. So the question is then not only if the systematic construction can hold up, but also the recessed preconditions on which the system itself is built. These considerations need to be brought to bear on default atheism, something that should be in question gets passed over. It is notable that among philosophers today, generally, there is a certain silence about the question of God. This is remarkable in comparison with earlier periods when the vocational identity of the philosopher seemed to demand almost the opposite. Remember in the Psalms that Anselm quotes, "The fool has said in his heart, there is no God." Now it's almost as if the fool who says in his heart there is no God is, for that reason, a fool. Richard Rorty, who was a celebrity intellectual until about 15 years ago, said somewhere that religion is a conversation stopper. And the implication is, I extend the comparison, I can imagine being in a very respectable sitting room in Victorian England and someone mentions sex or related topics, I can imagine a kind of icy silence descending on the respectable Victorians. Well, among some intellectuals today, if the word God or religion is mentioned, a similar silence can descend. Now, the interesting thing is that this default position isn't necessarily a worked out position at all or argued for. It can be a position in which one finds oneself or falls into without thought, and to which when intellectual or existential pressure is put on one's orientation, one returns. One falls back on a taken for granted atheism. So this is an idea I have that we are given to be in an ethos of being, but we reconfigure that ethos of being according to what we consider to be of greatest importance for us. But the reconfigured ethos of being can put into recess certain considerations that another configuration would allow to emerge. And default atheism, to a degree, is a reflection of forms of life that we have created in the already given ethos of being, which is always presupposed, but which I would argue don't do justice to the fullness of what is given to us in that more original ethos. And that part of our task as thinkers is to examine the reconfigured ethos and see if we can find a way to bring again to the surface some of these recessed possibilities in the more primal ethos. Just an example or two of a default position. If we think of the organic body, for instance, when it's put under strain by illness, there's a systematic unity at work in the internal organs of the body, but if it's put under strain, it tends to revert to certain positions. Again, this is a very simple example, but if you fast, again, this is the season of fasting, if you fast in a certain way, the body banks down, because it feels that the normal interchange between itself and sources of nutrition has dried up, and there's a default position inscribed in the body itself, which often comes into play. People who are on diets know this, of course, that for the first week they shed the pounds, like the Jew on a May morning. But after the first week, the Jew on the May morning seems to get thicker and thicker around the dropseed body. A little bit of Irish poetry there, if I'll be forgiven. the watery theme that seems to have followed me in my travels. Now, there are other examples of this, but it has been suggested, for instance, that the new atheists, the vociferousness and sometimes the heat with which they express their defense of atheism was, in a sense, the putting of a default position under pressure. The arguments that they gave were not necessarily very convincing, but nevertheless, the subterranean existence of this default position can sometimes be forced to the surface by certain social circumstances. Now, I think the interesting thing here is that the character of modern atheism is sometimes defined differently than in previous epochs. There are different kinds of atheism, modern atheism has sometimes claimed for itself moral superiority by comparison with the imputed self-subordination of the believer to an extrinsic norm or lawgiver. The tradition of natural theology attests to many intellectual forms of considering the divinity, but certainly from around the end of the 18th century, religion was sometimes explicitly seen as harboring deleterious consequences for human life, considered as a project of autonomy, considered as defined by morality without the sanction of God, morality as constituted in the light of human self-constitution, again as autonomous and as self-determining. Now, while this attitude had its seedling or sapling phases in earlier centuries, it has grown into what appears to be an entire orientation to life. The religious believer is the one who insults his own autonomy by submission to God as the big other. The big other is a phrase that Lacan uses and is reused by a person called Slobovan Žižek, perhaps the most famous intellectual celebrity in the world at the moment. In philosophy, we sometimes distinguish between continental tradition and the analytic tradition. And in the continental tradition, after Hegel, atheism becomes a much more widespread phenomenon. But it's also true of that other tradition called the analytic tradition. And I want to just quote from a philosopher who has been highly respected in that analytic tradition called Thomas Nagel. Again, some of you know all about this, but some of you don't. Nagel recounts how he recoils from, and I think this is extremely revealing. It's not an argument or anything, it's a confession. So people who are not Augustinians can confess their atheism in philosophical journals. So he recounts how he recoils from any thought of God that might seem insinuated by the direction of his own investigations. He does not want there to be a God. And then I just cite his actual words. In speaking of the fear of religion, I don't mean to refer to an entirely reasonable hostility towards certain established religions and religious institutions. So that's just the ordinary justified hostility to religion. In virtue of their objectionable moral doctrines, social policies, and political influence, Nor am I referring to the association of many religious belief with superstition and the acceptance of empirical falsehoods. I am talking about something much deeper, namely the fear of religion itself. I speak from experience, still quoting, being strongly subject to this fear myself. I want atheism to be true, and I'm made uneasy by the fact that some of the most intelligent and well-informed people I know are religious believers. It isn't just that I don't believe in God and naturally hope that I'm right in my belief, it's that I hope there is no God. I don't want there to be a God. I don't want the universe to be like that. So, end of citation. That seems to me that's an extraordinary statement and an extraordinary confession. And I think it instantiates what I'm calling the default atheism, in the sense that the atheism, it's not the outcome of an intelligent search, but governs the parameters of intellectual search. It is a presupposition of an orientation to the world, to things, to human existence, that governs in advance a sense of the whole, and that directs a more or less recessed predetermination of what is to be considered intelligible, true, or of worth. Now, if you look at some earlier philosophers like Kant and William James, you find perhaps the opposite. They give philosophies which want there to be a God. If you read Kant, he talks about how morality must be understood as making us think of the world as if there was a God. He doesn't say there is a God, but we must think as if there is a God. And similarly, if you read William James, who is a marvelous American philosopher in his own right, that will to believe, he wills that there be a God. So what constitutes the difference between someone like Kant or William James and Nagel? It seems to me actually it has something to do with the reconfigured ethos within which intellectual investigations are pursued. In the earlier time, the default position in a certain sense was what one might call default theism, if I would call it that, whereas now it has reversed into a kind of default atheism. How makes sense of that? When Nietzsche talks about the death of God, I think that he's talking about the shift, in a sense, from a default theism to a default atheism. And again, as I say, many philosophers have gone along with that particular shift. They haven't argued themselves into it. It's as if Nietzsche says somewhere, we have lost the taste for these questions. But what is a taste? A taste is something that often has to be cultivated, perhaps on the basis of natural propensities, but nevertheless, if you don't cultivate certain tastes for the most finessed of things, and you could say the question of God is the most finessed of all questions, but if you don't cultivate the taste for that, and again, I'm talking about an intellectual taste for it, then it simply doesn't register in one's perception of things. Okay, one final point here about this default atheism, and again, I'm playing with metaphors, but you know what it is to default. Now, again, maybe you don't. Your religious consecrated lives, many of you, you're not the bursar in the abbey. The bursar wakes up in the middle of the night and he remembers how the figures in the books don't quite work out. And he worries that the abbey is going to go into default. For the rest of you, you can sleep innocently on, and hopefully breakfast will be awaiting you when you arise in the morning. But we talk about a defaulting bank. We saw this on a global scale in 2008. The whole economic system seemed to go into default, and default in the sense that it couldn't meet its debts. The credit and the flow of credit seemed to disappear from the system as a whole. So I just want to make that connection that the whole question of a default position is bound up with credit. Credit itself is bound up with the word credo, credere, what one believes, what one considers most ultimately trustworthy. So this whole question of default atheism seems to me to raise the question of what we ourselves consider in the end most worthy of the ultimate trust. And if I'm not mistaken, the trust itself usually isn't paid attention to once the system is functioning. It's when the system begins to go off kilter, we begin to worry whether there are credible grounds for continuing that particular way. And hence the question would be whether something like a default atheism or a default theism in the end has the most trustworthy assets, so to say. I know it's a very crude metaphor. It's a metaphor that William James uses when he talks about the cash value of ideas. I'm not intending to be crude, but it's the question of credit. A dollar is a credit in the sense of a trustworthy piece of paper that allows you to make an exchange with another. The other, you know, again, I know there are counterfeit notes, there are all these complications attached to credit, but nevertheless, the connection with the religious side of things is secretly at work here also. Okay, I'm going to check my time here. I woke up this morning and I didn't know where I was in terms of time. It's at the end of the day now, and am I on Eastern time, or am I on Central time, or am I on European time? But then Dublin time is an hour behind Belgian time, so I don't think Augustine, when he said, "What is time?" and was perplexed, ever had these complications in his life. Augustine never suffered from jet lag. Okay, so I won't dwell on it too long, but I think, and I've hinted this already, that default atheism isn't just a self-evident position as it's often taken by intellectuals, but it's something that emerges in connection with our reconfiguration of the ethos of being. Now again, that's the kind of language I use, and should I apologize for the kind of language I use, but that's the kind of Desmondian stuff that some people like and some people perhaps don't like. But again, as I said at the start, I think you can argue there's a given ethos of being which we don't construct, within which we construct, and there's a reconfigured or a second ethos of being which we construct, but we construct it on the basis of what's already given to us. So that original givenness is extraordinarily important to acknowledge. And the sometimes resistance of that original givenness to our constructions. Because we have a tendency to think that what is really of ultimate worth is what we do with what is given to us, rather than in the mode of a certain openness or gratitude and indeed reverence for the original gift of being. We ourselves become the originators of the value of being, and in itself it does not possess being. So part of the exploration that I think needs to be undertaken is to look at our reconfiguration of being and to see if, again, as I said at the beginning, we can, as it were, excavate traces of something more originally given. And if we pay attention to this more original givenness of being, whether the question of God begins to shine again with a new sense of significance. Again, as I say, I think it's easy if you're in a culture where default theism is the governing norm, it's very easy to take the question of God for granted. Just as in a more atheistic culture, you take the atheism of life, as it were, as the fundamental position. So I'm not simply arguing for one versus the other. I am arguing against default atheism, to be sure, but it needs to be understood not just as a simple negation of theism, but rather as a reconstruction of life in which the sources out of which the question of God have often been covered over or blocked. And I think that that's one of the reasons why, for many intellectuals, these old questions about the existence of God don't figure so powerfully and passionately in their intellectual quests as they did in earlier times. And in response to that, I mentioned earlier Charles Taylor calls the imminent frame. He has a way of putting it in an analogous point by saying that in Western modernity, we live in the world as if we're within an imminent frame. And by that he means that the frame of imminence constitutes the encompassing horizon of significance for us. And in his reflections, he's trying to, in some sense, raise the possibility of a transcendence that breaks open the imminent frame. So what I'm doing here, in some sense, is not unrelated to that. But I try to argue that if we pay attention to imminent life, we don't have to end with the view that imminence as such constitutes the absolute horizon of life. That's what a philosophy of finitude since Kant has tended to say. All meaning is finite and nothing but finite. And I want to argue that that's what I call a postulatory finiteness. That we postulate that finiteness is that horizon beyond which nothing greater can be thought. Can you remember Anselm's definition of God? That being greater than which none can be thought. That definition of God, for some philosophers, has been transferred to finitude. And if you raise questions that seem to transgress that so-called postulated finitude, you are called out as doing something supposedly unacceptable. So in God and the Between, one of my books, I explore what I call the hyperboles of being. Now again, you're getting a quick a baptism into some of the particular phrases that I use, but they take on a more perhaps developed and even technical meaning in the discourse that I've tried to offer. Hyperbole. If someone speaks hyperbolically, they say too much. There's perhaps a danger of grandiloquence when you're talking hyperbolically. But the word hyperbole comes from the two Greek words hyperbalein. Again, apologies for the little lesson in Greek, but hyper means above, and the word balein means to throw. It's related to the word ball, you throw a ball. So a hyperbole throws us above, or is a matter of being thrown above. And I want to say that there are happenings in infinitude, or happenings in imminence, that have that hyperbolic character. It's not that they're false exaggerations of what's at play, but rather by attending to the riches of what is at play, we discover that it's not that we initiate ourselves a movement of self-transcendence, but we find ourselves already caught up in a transcending. We're being thrown above rather than simply throwing ourselves forward. In a way, what I'm doing is reversing Heidegger. You know, Heidegger is famous for talking about the fallenness, the Geworfenheit of the human being. We're thrown down. Sartre gives us the French bargain basement version of it when he talks about our being condemned to be free. But I think the hyperboles, in the sense that I'm suggesting, are actually a being thrown above oneself in a manner that exceeds our own self-determination. It's not a matter of self-determination, it's a matter of being offered a lift, so to say, that takes us above ourselves, outside of ourselves, beyond ourselves. And I distinguish four of them in God and the Between, but I'm only going to talk about one basically here tonight, the idiocy of being. So bear with me for a short, just quick summary. I talk about the idiocy of being, and that has to do with a real elemental intimacy. Now, I come back to that, but I also talk about the aesthetics of happening as hyperbolic, in a sense. If we attend to something like beauty or sublimity, we're thrown beyond ourselves. You respond to beauty not by standing in full autonomous self-control, but by being opened, by seeing something. You see a marvelous, beautiful human being, and you, that experience of wow, you're thrown back on yourself, but in being thrown back on yourself, you're actually at the same time rocked outside of yourself towards the beautiful that you see. Music is a great example that I think has a deep religious significance. a piece of music is heard through an open window, and suddenly you're transported into a different space. It's not the result of your self-determination. It's not the result of your decision or your voluntary accession to something. It's rather there's a movement that catches you up and, as we often say, simply transports you. I'd like to tell the story about Kant. Kant, the great philosopher of music, was quite irritated with the power of music to transport us without our giving it permission to do so. In the Critique of Judgment, he compares it to a dandy, a gentleman who, in those days, gentlemen went around with perfumed handkerchiefs. So I have a little, it's not perfumed, I'm sorry. But if we were in an 18th century drawing room, this would be perfumed. I'd take it out and suddenly the fragrance would waft through the room and everyone would be touched by it. I mean, we have this experience. Someone, a perfume comes off someone. Why do you think women wear perfumes? Now, again, I'd be accused of saying something sexist by even just mentioning the word woman. I plead guilty, okay? When you travel, the first thing you see when you go into the airport are all the perfumes. You have to pass the perfumes to get to the whiskey at the end of the line. So there's a lot of money in perfumes. I can tell you. Okay, that has nothing to do with... But Kant objected to music as being like the perfume that takes over, that comes over you, without by your leave. It doesn't ask your permission. The music enters and passes through the room in the way that a perfume does, and it changes us. But it doesn't ask our permission. We don't sign a contract before the music starts saying, okay, transport me, you have my permission. My lawyers have looked over the contract and everything's in order. No, it happens to us. Forgetting about the idiocy of being, but just one last story about Kant, because he's full of these stories that are ontologically revealing. It seems as if he lived close by a prison. And on Saturdays, the prisoners used to sing hymns, sacred songs. I think it was enforced. I don't think it was a voluntary the prisoners weren't overcome with a kind of a divine mania and wanting to sing, you know, Nearer My God to Thee or any such marvelous composition. And Kant had to listen to these prisoners, these convicts, were singing these hymns just down the road. And he has a footnote in the Critique of Judgment, considered one of the great works of philosophy in Western tradition, and he takes his revenge on the prisoners because he gives out about the involuntary singing of hymns by prisoners, whereby he says, we are forced to stop our meditations while it's going on. So in other words, you have this image of Kant, let's say Saturday morning, Sunday morning, he's trying to write, you know, does God exist? The prisoners start singing, and he has to stop thinking because the music intrudes on him. So I have this very irreverent picture of Kant forced to sing along with the convicts. Nobody pays any attention to those little footnotes, but they're very human, and they say something about what I'm calling the aesthetics of happening. The third hyperbole I call the erotics of selving. Now, when the word erotics appears, some people in certain contexts, certain things also appear on the screen. But I know I can use the word erotics here without any of those kind of thoughts appearing. I'm talking about erotics as this energy of self-surpassing, which of course can take a sexual form, but it's in a sense a very platonic thought, that we are as self-surpassing beings, as self-transcending, self-overcoming in a certain sense. So I think that that is also something that it's a happening in immanence that takes us to the boundary or threshold of immanence. Something about our erotic self-surpassing is very difficult to interpret in entirely immanent, determinate terms. Again, when people are overtaken with the madness of love, for instance, rationally speaking, it makes no sense. And yet, if you're caught up in a passion like that, and somebody tries to reason you out of it, it's mostly not very effective. Now, that seems like a deficiency of reason, but it could be the case that there's something more in our being that is oriented to something beyond our normal sense of determinable reason. And it may have a reason, so to say. There may be a wisdom at work in that self-surpassing, which we need to pay very serious attention to. And the last hyperbole I call the agapeics of communication. So the contrast of agape and eros is present in my work. But I think there's something hyperbolic about agape. I've talked to some people here today about that, but about agapeic love, there's a generosity that gives from a fullness that's already real. It's not that you give because you want a reciprocal return, simply, but a generosity that gives, and that, strangely enough, in giving is not depleted. We often think, if I give you something, then I have deprived myself of something. But this is a strange love, which in giving itself to the other, finds not only that the other is augmented, but the very love, as giving itself, augments the giver. So it's a strange movement, very difficult to understand philosophically, from fullness to fullness, not from a lack to fulfillment, but from fullness to fullness. Philosophers don't talk about these things in the terms that I'm just offering you, but I think all of us in our honest and perhaps best moments of life do experience the even saving power of that type of generosity, which of course, again, most evidently within the Christian tradition is identified with God. Okay, check the time again. It goes faster as you get older. That's just for the older people in the audience, of which I see one or two. Having recently retired at Leuven, I'm a little bit more sensitive to the latter stages of the human enterprise. Okay, just then, the idiocy of being and the third way. So to come back to the idiocy, I'm using the word idiot in a sense that draws from the Greek word idiotes. It's a Greek word originally. And it can mean a kind of idiot, but that's a kind of an extended meaning that has come to be. An idiot is someone who doesn't explicitly engage themselves in the more public sphere. So there's an element of the reserved and indeed perhaps even the private. The word private is not a Greek word per se, but I think that there's a certain intimacy of being that is, so to say, on the threshold of articulation, but that is not exhausted by the more neutral public generalities that we often feel more at home in. And I think that this is profoundly important for the third way. You know, the third way, as I briefly mentioned at the beginning, if all being is possible being, it is, but it might not be. The sheer fact that it is at all is an idiotic happening, in a sense. It is, it might not be, there's no absolute necessity attached to the fact that it is at all. And for that particular reason, it seems to escape the generalizing tendency of most philosophers. The sheer that it is of something is not some generality about all beings. It's a quality of ontological givenness, a quality perhaps of ontological, the power of what is as is to suggest something more than itself. So the sense of the intimate, we mostly know this idiocy in relation to ourselves, this intimacy in relation to ourselves. And again, it's very interesting to think of the human being as the most idiotic being in the whole of creation. Because for us, the inwardness of our being opens up to us. And the inwardness of our being has a singularity that, in a certain respect, can't be generalized in, again, this neutral, universalizing sense. We're all familiar with St. Augustine and his famous description of God as interior intimo meo, more interior to me than I am to myself, as it's sometimes thought of. But we're intimate to ourselves, And then Augustine, as it were, doubles the stakes and says that where the intimacy of God is kind of heightened, intimacy to a second degree. How difficult it is to understand what is going on in the intimacy of our own being if we just simply consider it as our own. How difficult it is to know oneself. But if the divine is intimate to the hyperbolic degree, how approach that perhaps ultimate intimacy? I haven't it written here in the paper at the moment, but it's clear to me that the practices of meditative prayer, for instance, are ways in which individuals and communities find ways of trying to enter again into the space of this hyperbolic intimacy. It's perhaps not incidental that when people do find themselves in a space that looks a little bit more mystical, they often say crazy things. They say crazy things that the more you know, the institutionalized community is at home with the more generalized and more neutralized universals. And then some strange individual surfaces saying things which might just be idiotic, of course, but they might be idiotic as redolent of a divine wisdom that has been perhaps forgotten by the community. In any case, idiotic doesn't necessarily have to mean the opposite of something intelligible in the language I'm using here, quite the opposite. Idiocy is inseparable from communicability, I would argue. Think of this word, an idiom. A person has an idiom. Idiom is the same word, as it comes from the same root as idiotes. But a poet has his idiom, that singular way of expressing himself. A people have their idioms, the singular ways in which a particular group of people characteristically express themselves. If you're not within the space of that idiocy, then it's just perhaps gibberish to you. But that's the judgment of an outsider who hasn't entered this intimacy of being. And I'm wanting to say that that it is of existence is idiotic in that respect, that it has this intimacy that is not reducible to a more neutral or abstract universal. And some philosophers, I think, are relatively deficient in a feel for this ontological idiocy, as I'm calling it, or intimacy. I think Kant is deficient in it. I seem to be beating up on Kant tonight, but maybe I am beating up on Kant. Okay, tough luck, Kant. but Hegel, as a person also, I think, is very deficient in what I'm calling ontological astonishment before the that it is of things. Many philosophers have tended to be more concerned with the what of things than the that of things at all. And my suggestion is not peculiar to me. It's other commentators on Aquinas' third way pay attention to that. I suppose the difference between what they say and what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to place this that it is within a more articulate context that does justice to the sense of the ethos of being, and also does justice to the fact that we can pass over this strange marvel of being at all. We can construct a second ethos where we're interested in determining what things are all the time. We determine what this is, what we ourselves are, often with the intention of becoming more powerfully self-determining. But this that it is that a dimension that can't be reduced to a what, and certainly can't become simply the servant of our own will to self-determination. It's again confronting it's almost like face to face with a sense of a mystery that will continue to exceed us. Let me just read a bit here, since I actually have things written here, believe it or not, but the time is almost gone. The givenness of being is as there, and so it seems without a why, but we ask why it seems without a why. It is not enough to repeat Angelus Silesius, that the rose is without a why. A lot of the Heidegger and others have cited that, and they think that's the end of the exploration. But there are different ways of asking why, some seeking a more precise and univocal determination of being as given, Others, astonished, perhaps perplexed by something that exceeds finite univocal determination. Such another whying would have to inform, say, the cosmological argument. Again, another name for the third way. For it to come to life anew. This is the hyperbolic dimension. The determinacy of what is there is not airbrushed out in a speculative washing away of givenness, but there is more than determinacy in the determinate. There is the saturation of it with the overdeterminacy. There is a that it is that precedes determinate rationalization and that exceeds it. Is it then just absurd, as other to determinative reason? I would say not at all. It may be absurd relative to the latter, determinative reason, but it is not absurd. It insinuates the overdeterminate, the more than determinate, as intelligible beyond univocal intelligibility, as worthy of affirmation, and in that sense good, in a sense overdeterminate to every determinate incarnation of the worthy. So in the idiocy of being, there's a shine of what Plato calls the good beyond being. If there is a surd, it is a benign surd, not an inhospitable absurd. So that's, in the 20th century particularly, the presence of the sense of the absurd is very widespread. But I think there is a surd character to the fact that things are at all. But the issue for deeper exploration is whether the surd is just absurd, or whether there is something like a more benign surd, as I put it there. Here, actually, you could bring in the idea of the comic as relevant to the matter, because the comic deals with the absurd in one sense, the absurd character of so much of human existence. But in certain comic movements, there's a festive affirmation of life. There are forms of the comic and laughter that are mocking and nihilistic, but there are, sometimes we acknowledge the absurdity in a laugh that releases this affirmative, this ontologically affirmative that has the strange power to restore us to life again. So I think that a default atheism is often deficient in this sense of ontological astonishment that is at work in what I'm suggesting here. And that indeed at times, if it has that sense of the absurd, it's willing to let it be just a groundless absurdity, rather than approaching it in the orientation of it as perhaps the threshold of the marvel of pure given being as such. I'm turning pages. I sometimes, if I'm at a lecture and I'm not totally taken by the lecture, I try to look at how thick the number of pages are that are left. I think that's a pretty good idea. The next time I give a lecture, I'm going to bring in a huge sheaf of papers. And I'll show it to the audience, and there'll be about an inch left after an hour. And I know I will see faces of despair looking up at me. Apologies for that. I haven't really gotten to St. Thomas. And there are versions of this argument. It's sometimes called the cosmological argument in modernity. Leibniz has a marvelous version of it, which basically says, if something exists, God exists. Maximum compression in the logical statement. Kant has a discussion of the cosmological argument, and he is particularly putting the stress on a sense of indeterminate existence. He thinks it doesn't work, but that's for other reasons than just the sense of existence as such. But I think that Aquinas' way of thinking is dependent. I won't say it's dependent, but I think that the recessed ontological presuppositions are very much bound up with the feeling that all being comes to be. So I'm putting it in terms now that are perhaps consonant with what I'm saying here. A theological way of talking about creation would be perfectly appropriate here, but creation signifies not just a becoming of things, not just a coming to be of things, but a giving of coming to be, which is not simply coming to be or becoming. That when we pay attention to creation as given, there are signs, so to say, suggesting this origin of coming to be that gives all beings to be. It's not on the surface of Aquinas' argument, and I know Thomists, particularly Dominicans, will try and correlate it with various other parts of the Summa or Aquinas' work, but I'm trying to, if you like, reanimate the argument in terms of recessed ontological presuppositions rather than just simply give a scholarly investigation of, say, the sources of Aquinas' discourse. And I think that this sense of creation has this strange doubleness about it. Things are, but they might not be. And all that is a sort of double. The creature is double. It incontrovertibly is, but the character of its being at all, its isness, is always shadowed by the possibility of not being, and hence always on the threshold of perhaps returning to not be at all. And the act of creation itself is just that equipoising, that bringing into equipoise between not being at all and, in fact, incontrovertibly being now as given to be. I think philosophically we can explore what gives itself in terms like that. Sorry, my time is almost up. I feel like a man facing the executioner, and I haven't been able to eat my last meal yet, which would have been a more detailed account of Aquinas' proof. Okay, let me. Since the advertisement said something about the third way, I really feel that I have to say something about it a bit more. So I'm almost at the end. This proof is called from possibility and necessity. I think it has a deeper significance than Kant's version. How might this third way run? And this is a kind of reconstruction of it. Putting it most concisely in terms that are not quite Aquinas's, if all being is possible being, ultimately all possible being is impossible. So the finite world is contingent, things come to be and pass out of being. In the endlessness of becoming, there is one possibility that would be realized at some point, namely that there would be no contingent being. So I'm kind of, for purposes of the argument, accepting that there is the possibility of infinite time. But then if that's the case, then all of the possibilities might in principle be realized. After all, everything finite might not be, and at some time in the infinite time of endless becoming, the possibility of everything not being will be. If this possibility of everything not being is possible, then nothing could ever come to be, for nothing comes from nothing. Hence, nothing could now exist. Again, this is, as I say, a reconstruction. Thus, if everything is contingent, not even contingent existence now is possible. This is absurd, because the world of contingency is actually given. There must be another being not contingent to make contingency intelligible, possible, actual. And again, in Aquinas, he talks about necessity through another and then necessity through itself and so on. In a way of imaging this, and again, I perhaps almost come to the end, I've thought about it in connection with someone like Nietzsche, a strange bed partner for someone like Aquinas, but Nietzsche gives the image of the whole as a circle that keeps returning to itself, the eternal recurrence of the same. But the definition of possibility is like a coin with two sides. This is contingency. On one side is a zero, and on one side is a one. Okay, just think of that. Now, this is a kind of visual help. You have a coin, one side zero. If you could have zero on one side of something, but you have one side zero, one side one, denoting existence. Suppose in the infinity of time, all the coins that are contingent are cast, they're thrown up in the air. Well, the meaning of Aquinas' argument, I think, is that nothing will come down if all the zeros come up, if you know what I mean. It's an effort to visualize that one of the possibilities in infinite time is that all of the zeros come up at the same time, which means there is no time, and that nothing comes up. So in other words, you get an absurdity. If that is the only form of being that is possible, indeed actual, you deconstruct even the possibility of contingent being. And, you know, Nietzsche is deficient in ontological astonishment, because what he wants to do is he wants a circle of becoming, a circle of self-becoming, and doesn't want to acknowledge that for something to become, it must come to be in the first instance and perhaps be given to be. So he creates a circle which is in many respects like the default atheism that reconfigures ontological happenings so that the communication of something from beyond immanence no longer makes itself felt. Okay. So see what I've just offered as a kind of thought experiment, if you like, in relation to Aquinas' third way, that if it's to have any success, has something to do with stunning us into a renewed sense of the marvel of the that it is at all of things, this idiocy of being. So I'm not really offering a reconstruction of Aquinas as a more sort of strict logical argument. I rather think, actually, if you just take it at that particular level, you just end up with logical sticks that have withered. You haven't, the sticks haven't put their roots into a living ground. And I think that that's part of the task that we as philosophers face in relation to these older ways of thinking. Page turning. So I would suggest that if the full import, I'm going to read my last paragraph that I have here, so we'll call it a night. If the full import of the hyperboles is understood, I think we can begin to wake up from the sleep of default atheism, and it is impossible to accept it either as a point of departure or a point or a place of arrival. There are signs in the idiotic overdeterminate givenness of being. That's what I mainly focused on, but there are also signs in aesthetic happening, that second hyperbole, especially as shown in the sublime as the overdeterminate appearing in sensuous determinacy. There are signs in erotic selving as carried in its self-surpassing by an energy of being overdeterminate to all our own self-determinings. There are signs in agape communications where the overdeterminacy of divine goodness passes between finitude and infinity in a released metaxological community of surplus generosity. Derrida said, quote, "I rightly pass for an atheist," and his admirers went merrily to work parsing this gnomic utterance. One is put in mind of Heraclitus when he said, "The Lord whose oracle is at Delphi does not utter nor hide, but gives a sign." We do need signs. We do need to figure the signs. What I'm calling the hyperboles are signs communicating from before default atheism and from beyond it. Speaking myself, I would have to say, I could not rightly pass for an atheist. Could I rightly pass for a theist? And if so, how pass? That is a good question. It is my hope that the thoughts above give some signs of what might rightly pass for an answer. Thank you.